Dear students, today we will discuss vector processing under pipelining and vector processing chapter 9 of your book. Here, let us see what is a vector. A vector of length n, also called a row vector, because it is arranged in row. If it would be in column, then we will call it column vector. So a vector of length n has n elements, v1, v2, v3, v5, n elements. So you can see it's like a single dimensional array. So this is a vector. Ith element of a vector v is denoted as vi. So vector is a set of data having n elements, n can be 1000, 100, whatever. Now here you see in a scalar processing, conventional scalar processing, what we do if we want to add two vectors, that means ith element of A is added to ith element of B to generate ith element of C. For I equals to 1 to 100. So A1, B1 added to get C1, A2, B2 added to get C2, and so on. So this is a loop in a high level language like Fortran, where we repeat a loop do 1 to 100. This is label, go to 20 and do this. So this is how a scalar processor performs this addition of two vectors. If we go in detail of this operation, in conventional scalar computer, the loop is processed in this way. First, I initialize with 0, then read AI, read BI, then perform add operation and store operation. AI plus BI is equal to CI, and then store CI, and then increment I equals to I plus 1. If I is less than equals to 100, then go to 20. That means this label 20, and then repeat this, read next I, read next BI, and calculate CI, and so on. So this is how, if we want to add 100 elements of A to corresponding element of B to generate 100 elements of C, the loop is processed in this way in a scalar processing. Vector processing is different from this in the manner that if we have a vector processor, we will write a single instruction like this. C equals to C 1 to 100 equals to A 1 to 100 plus B 1 to 100. That means corresponding elements of A and B are added to generate element of C. So this single instruction would be enough for a computer which have vector processing capabilities. To perform this addition, a floating point adder, which we have studied in arithmetic pipeline we have studied, where we took an example of floating point adder, is used. Here, an instruction format of a vector processor is given. This is operation code like add. This is base address of source. Source is like source 1 is A. So base address is given here. Base address of source 2. So base address of source 2 is B. Address is given here. Base address of destination. So where to start storing the result. C is the destination, and vector length. So vector length is 100 here. So in this way, the instruction of the vector processor is performed. So this is the format for instruction. Now here we take an example how pipeline vector processing is done. say I want to perform this operation C equals to A1 B1 plus A2 B2 plus A3 B3 plus A4 B4 up to AK BK. This can be say 100,000 K. So I want to perform this. Using a pipeline, I can do this vector processing in this way. Say this is my source A, where A1, A2, A3, A4, A5 are stored. This is source B, where B1, B2, B3, B4, B5 are stored. This is a multiplier pipeline. Multiplier pipeline means here I can perform A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3, A4, B4, and I can feed them to adder pipeline where their addition is performed. You see, here multiplier pipeline have four segments and adder pipeline have also four segments. So how it works, let us see. Initially in multiplier, all the four values storage are 0000, and in adder also 0000. In next clock cycle, A1 will be taken from here, A2, B1 will be taken from here, and multiplier will work, and A1, B1 is stored at this location. There are four location in this adder pipeline also. So in next clock cycle, what will happen? This A1, B1 will be shifted here, and A2, B2 will come here. In next clock cycle, A1, B1 will go here, A2, B2 will come here, and A3, B3 will be here. In next clock cycle, this is the position of multiplier pipeline registers. So A1, B1 is multiplied and stored here, A2, B2 is stored here, A3, B3 is stored here, and A4, B4 is stored here. While doing these four cycles, A1, B1, A2, B2, A3, B3 in multiplier, what is happening in the adder pipeline? In adder pipeline, you can see that one input is going from here and one input is going from here. So these two values are added. One value is this and one value is this. So in first clock cycle, when multiplier was multiplying A1, B1, this adder was adding this zero and this zero, and result is here. So in these four cycles, adder pipeline results are not changed because every time 0, 0, 0 is added. Now you see here in next cycle that A1, B1, which was here, is input to this adder, and 1, 0, which was here, is input to this adder. So A1, B1 and that 0 is added. So A1, B1 goes here. And in multiplier, A2, the values are shifted. A2, B2 here, A3, B3 is here, A4, B4 is here, and new value A5, B5 is here. When the same process is repeated in next clock cycle, next clock cycle, next clock cycle, ultimately A1, B1 reaches here, A2, B2 reaches here, A3, B3 reaches here, A4, B4 reaches here, because only these zeros were going out and was added when A2, B2 was thrown out from this multiplier to adder. Now, see at this position, and now you think what will be the next position. See, in next position, this A5, B5 will go out of this multiplier, A9, B9 will come here, A8, B8 will shift here, A7, B7 will shift here, A6, B6 will shift here. So this A5, B5 will go here to this input, and this A1, B1 will go to the adder's input itself. So here will come summation of A1, B1 and A5, B5 like this. So in next clock cycle, A9, B9 is here, A8, B8 is here, A7, B7 is here, A6, B6 is here, So A5, B5 was the input for here, and A1, B1 from this side. So both of these are added and stored here. The values were shifted like this. In this way, when we will keep moving the clock, what will happen that this A2, B2 will now be added to A6, B6. This result will be shifted here, and A2, B2 and B6, A6 is summation is here. Similarly, A3, B3 will be in next clock cycle will be added with A7, B7. A4, B4 will be added to A8, B8. And then again, in next clock cycle, A1, B1, A5, B5 and A9, B9 will be added and will come here. In this way, A1, B1, A5, B5, A9, B9, A13, B13 and so on, these will be added and result will be somewhere in this adder pipeline. A2, B2, A6, B6, A10, B10. So there is a gap of 4. 1, 5, 9, 13. 2, 6, 4, 10, 14. 3, 7, 11, 15. So this will become one set of summation. This will become second set of summation. This will become third set of summation. This will become fourth set of summation. And these all values, when four values will be added, we will get output of this. So the complete vector operation of this kind is performed in a pipeline. The benefit of pipeline, we have many times discussed that when we need to perform many operations and pipeline has k segments, the first output is generated in k clock cycle, and after that in each clock cycle one output is generated. This speeds up the scalar processor by a multiple of k times. K is the number of segments. That is an ideal situation, and we have also derived the expression for this speed up. So this is how a pipeline vector processing is performed. So for pipeline vector processing, now here we are introducing you the concept of memory interleaving, which is required in pipeline vector processing. What is memory interleaving? First, you need to understand that in pipeline and vector processing, we need simultaneous access to memory. That means memory is accessed at the same time by multiple modules, multiple segments. Say in instruction pipeline, one segment is fetching the operation and another segment is fetching the operand. So they both may require simultaneous memory access. In case of arithmetic pipeline, two segments may require operands from the memory. So it is quite possible in pipeline and vector processor that simultaneous memory access is required. This simultaneous memory access can be done if we have multiple buses, multiple data bus, multiple address bus. But that is a costly affair. So what we do a memory interleaving. Memory interleaving means we partition the memory into number of small modules which are connected to a common memory address and data bus. So address bus and data bus will be common, but memory is divided or partitioned. These partition can be logical or physical, but the memory is partitioned in number of modules like this. So there is only a single common address bus and there is a common data bus. But this is a memory array. That means if memory has say 1000 bytes, then 100 bytes or 250 bytes here, 250 bytes here, 250 bytes here, 250 bytes here. So these are the modules of memory. Module means this complete setup, and this is memory array. Individual register AR for this memory array, individual register data register is there for this also. Similarly, each memory array has address register and data register separately, and they are connected to the common address bus and data bus. What is the benefit of doing this? Say, when we read or write in memory, data is uploaded in DR register and address is uploaded in AR register. So if I do the read-write operation for this module, the read-write operations takes long time. Meanwhile, the bus is free. So I load some address to this and some data to this DR register. Then read-write operation is performed. In case of read operation, only address is uploaded and from memory data is sent to DR. In case of write operation, data is also uploaded in DR from data bus. Address is also uploaded from AR in address from address bus, and then at that address this data is written in write case. In read case, only AR is uploaded, data is read from memory and sent to DR. So how it is useful? I upload AR and DR according to my need, read write. When this memory module is reading write, performing the read write operation, the buses are free. So I can give assignment to some other module also. I can assign address to this module and read operation to this module. So this module will be reading, performing read operation, and data will be sent to DR. When this is busy doing that, I can assign a task to this module also. So the time of read and write is saved, and parallel operations read-write can be performed whenever bus is free. When read-write operation is performed and it takes time, bus is free, so that can be utilized. So in this example, memory is divided in four segments, these four arrays, that is four modules. So lower bit of address, two bits, 0001, 1011, they can be used to identify from which memory array we want to perform read-write operation. So this is what we call memory interleaving. By definition, it is partitioning of memory, having common bus for address, common bus for data. But the address register and data registers are different for each module. Here is a summary. Memory module is a memory array with its own AR and DR. AR receive information from address bus and DR communicate with the bidirectional data bus. DR can read from memory or it can give data to memory in write operation. The two least significant address bits, so address have least significant two bits, they are used to distinguish among the four modules in this example. One module may initiate a memory access when other modules are in process of reading or writing. So this is what memory interleaving, which is required in pipelining or vector processing. And why it is required? Because pipelining and vector processing may need simultaneous access of memory. These are the references. Thank you very much. Please read it from the book and prepare your notes. Thank you.